Welcome to the Local Small Business Coach Podcast, where we discuss everyday challenges local small business owners face and help to provide the information you need to increase your profits, boost your sales, improve your processes, and develop stronger teams. So if you're looking to take your local small business to the next level, let's dive in. Here's your coach, Tammy Adams.
Hey, badass local small business owners. Welcome to another episode of the Local Small Business Coach Podcast, where each episode we work on getting you to $100,000 in take-home pay. Today we're going to discuss bookkeeping and why it is a necessary evil. So if you're ready to boost your profits, increase your sales, improve your processes, and develop stronger teams, let's dive in. Hey everybody, how's it going? Well, you know, one of the things that I probably get a lot of questions on is bookkeeping and the fact that we all hate it. Okay, maybe not all of us. Some of us like numbers. You know, I like numbers and we all like money. I think we can all agree that we all like money. We do this because we want to earn lots and lots of money. That's why I always say, we want to get to the point where you all can take home $100,000 in take-home pay so that you can put it in your pocket. Now, listen, here's the thing. Bookkeeping is a huge piece to that, but I get why it's not everybody's favorite thing to do. And it's not saying that you don't like numbers and whatnot. I hate doing bookkeeping, but I love numbers. It's a really weird thing. For how much I love looking and diving into things, I hate the actual process of doing bookkeeping. When I had my Baskin Robbins, I was great at it. I had a process, which we'll talk about in a minute. Now, because I'm more helter-skelter, it's not on a daily basis because I don't do some of that. It's created a whole problem even for myself. But I also know it's a necessary evil, so I do it anyways. And I want to challenge each of you guys on this process. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about why bookkeeping is a necessary evil in our business. And while it's not sexy and while it's not fun, it is probably one of the most important things that you can do. And like I said, I get a lot of people reaching out to me about this piece of their business. So today we're just going to highlight a lot of the stuff, but I'm going to try to create some more things for everybody to help really dive in to this piece of the business a little bit better and how to make it a little bit less painful, but more importantly, how we get you to that $100,000. But I can tell you everything under the sun, but if you just don't pay attention to your bookkeeping, you're costing yourself lots of money. I promise you. It may seem like you're not, but you are. And we'll talk a little bit about that today, like I said, but I've got some cool things I'm kicking around that I want to try to do over the next few weeks. So hopefully as business starts to die down for some of you guys, you actually can spend a little bit more time on this piece of your business. Now, the biggest challenge with bookkeeping is finding the time to do it. Let's face it, we make the money when we're out there working and when we're out there doing. So a lot of time what happens is we know mentally that we need to do our bookkeeping, but unfortunately what happens is we kind of put it aside, if you will, and move on to the other things that we need to do. But the reality is we need to actually make it a priority and we need to set aside time to do it. Now, each of your businesses are a little bit different. If you are somebody that has daily sales, like you're a brick and mortar or you do a lot of products, then you probably already have a better process than most of the folks that are mobile businesses or go to other people's homes because you're a captured audience, if you will, which is why I was saying about mine personally, when I was a captured audience in a brick and mortar, it was much easier for me to set aside time every single morning to work on my numbers. I would key in the receipts from the day before. I would make sure that the processes in the register were all done. I was able to transfer them over into my spreadsheets, into my QuickBooks and stuff like that. Much easier as a brick and mortar. So if you're in a brick and mortar today, you really want to make sure that you carve out a set time. And I do recommend it being the first thing you do every morning. Now, granted, a lot of times the first thing you have to do is get your store ready to be opened and whatnot. But usually you don't have tons of business when you first open. At least most businesses don't. Or you can go in half hour to 45 minutes or an hour earlier and do your bookkeeping prior to you opening up your business. Brick and mortar, there's no excuse for you not to have a set time to do your books. And the first thing in the morning is the perfect time to do it because you just have all of that stuff you're getting from the day before. So all you got to do is transfer it and make it there. But the biggest thing, you need to set aside the time to do it. Now, for those of you not in a brick and mortar, you also need to set aside time to do it. And there's no reason really for you not to do it first thing in the morning either, before you run off to your jobs. Now, for some of you, I get it. It's hot. You got to get out first thing in the morning before it gets too bad, in which case yours might be an end of the day type of thing. I don't care if you do it first thing in the morning or the end of the day. But what my biggest challenge to every single one of you, brick and mortar, mobile, going out to homes, does not matter. You need to have a daily time every day to do this. And if you can't do it daily, maybe you don't have that much. Maybe what you do is you set a weekly time. You do it every single Friday. You do it every single Monday to start the week off. Probably the best thing to do is either have it first thing Monday morning. It's what you start your week with, or you end your week before you close down business doing it. So maybe that Saturday or Sunday you set aside half hour, hour, 2 hours to wrap up your business from the week prior. I'm not one of those people that are going to absolutely tell you it needs to be here, but what I am telling you is you need to pick something and you need to make it on your calendar non-negotiable. You're going to do that, whether it's every morning, every Monday, every Friday, every Tuesday. I don't care. You need to make sure that you stay on top of your bookkeeping. But here's the thing, bookkeeping encompasses a lot of stuff. So you may find that you break up the whole bookkeeping process depending upon which pieces of bookkeeping that you need. So let's kind of break that up a little bit and then take a look at how it works and impacts your particular business. Now, for some of you, part of the bookkeeping process is going to be estimating and invoicing. If you have to do estimates for people, quotes, if you will, then you need to have a process in place that you're going to do that. So maybe there's certain days that you go out and you do your, you go out to do the free quote, you go out and do the estimate. But the problem is that for most of you, you're going to be doing it on a regular daily basis. So for example, in case of my handyman, if I meet him out at a house or he meets one of my clients, keep in mind, people that have you come out to their home, they're expecting that estimate back within a reasonable time. Now, it's very important that you give them the right timelines, and you need to try to be competitive, because here's the thing. If you're a painter and you're going out and you're giving a bid, you're going to probably give them a rough estimate, but you might say, you know what, I'm going to write this up and I'm going to get it back to you. Well, if they're talking to several different people, you can't be the last person to get your bid in. You want to be somebody that does it. If you tell them, hey, I'm going to get this to you within 24 hours, great. But if all the other painters are getting it to them within 12 hours, then you have to, and you keep losing business, that might be why. They're beating you to the punch. They're getting back to these people quicker. So you need to tweak your turnaround on your estimates to fit the needs within the marketplace. But more importantly, you need to communicate it. Communication, communication, communication. I'm always going to tell you this. This is a killer for so many local small business owners. You must communicate to the client. So if you're going to do an estimate, you need to communicate that. Now, you're probably wondering why this is part of the bookkeeping process, because keep in mind, this is step one. In many cases, your estimates roll into an invoice later on. So I'm not going to keep harping on estimates. We can talk about that as a separate thing. Because here's the thing, you get the job, now you've got you do the job, and now you've got an invoice. And here's where the problem comes in. Because let's just say you don't estimate and you just invoice. That's fine too. So if you have a business where you go straight to invoicing is a place where a lot of people lose money. And you're probably wondering, Tammy, how on earth do people lose money on invoicing? It's real simple. Sometimes they do the job and you don't get the invoice right away. Here's the thing. When you do a job, if you do the job at 9 o'clock in the morning, before the end of the day, they need to have an invoice unless you have them pay you right then and there, which is probably the best thing. But there are some businesses where they don't pay until later. It's just the way that you have it set up. So ideally, you want to get paid right away and you want to have an invoice, capture that and get paid. If not, you need to get that invoice off by the end of the day and expect payment immediately for that. But here's where some of that problem comes in. Because you're so busy, you send out the invoice and you don't follow up. And they know it. So they don't pay you right away. And then they're going to start paying you on their timeline. I just had a client, greatest lady in the world. Okay. She had two different things done. So we're trying to sell her house. She had two different things done and she had set aside the money for both of these projects to be done. But here's the thing. And the first one got done and I'm like, here's the stuff. You need to pay this guy. Okay. I'll take care of it. Then we did some other work. Here's the invoice. You need to pay this guy. No problem. I've got the money. I'll take care of it. Well, guess what? Like I said, she's the sweetest lady in the world, would never hurt anyone at all. She was so busy between trying to move, her job, take care of her kid, who's very active in the community. It's like a week and a half, 2 weeks later, and she hadn't paid either one of these people. And here's the thing. She had not heard from either one of those folks that she was still paying. And I'm talking almost $1,000 to both of them. And, you know, finally, when I'm realizing that I'm like, hey, I find out not from the vendors who didn't even reach out to me to find out what was going on. They didn't reach out to her. They didn't reach out to me, even though I hooked the two of them together. I find out because I'm talking to her as we're wrapping up the sale. And I'm like, okay, so you already took care of this and you took care of this. She goes, oh, I keep forgetting to pay those. I need to get those done. And I'm like, I need you to stop and pay them right now. One, we have to have these done before we can close on your home. But in the back of my head, I'm screaming, these two vendors didn't even make sure that they were getting paid. And one of them I know needs the money. So that was even crazier. So believe it or not, one of the challenges a lot of folks have is poor follow-up on invoicing. And here's the thing. I'll even have folks that will send out an invoice and say, okay, if you don't pay in 2 weeks, you owe an additional $50. Okay, great. You're going to get an extra $50. But here's the thing. It should never get that far. Granted, don't get me wrong. I'm not naive, and I know there's certain people that aren't going to pay you. But if you've got certain people that aren't paying you on a regular basis, why are you doing work for them? Why are you taking all this extra energy to give business to someone who's not valuing your business? Now, is there a time and a place to deal with somebody who's very poor at paying their bills? Yeah, if they are somebody who is a magnet to get you more business, that they keep referring you out to other people and you getting great leads off of them, yeah, probably have a little bit more lenience with working with them. But if they offer no other value to you, and other than the fact they don't respect your time and energy and money, then you're going to have to make a call if you keep them. But the biggest problem is, are you following up on those invoicing? You have to ask yourself, are you doing them first? And then two, are you following up to ensure that you get paid? Are you making sure that you're doing the steps? Do you have a process in place to be able to do this? Because remember, the more you put it off, the more money that you're going to lose. Now, this is one of the reasons why, in a minute, I'm going to talk about QuickBooks and FreshBooks and stuff like that. But I'm telling you, this is one of the reasons why I'm a huge, huge fan of FreshBooks. Because what I love about FreshBooks is when you put out an invoice, it actually tells you when they open up the email. And I can't tell you how many people will sit there and they go, oh, I never saw it. I didn't get it. Well, you know what? In FreshBooks, you know they opened it because it tells you they opened it. But the biggest thing that I want to try to get across in this part is that you need to make sure that you're sending out the invoicing and that you're making sure that you follow up to ensure that you get paid. This leads me to the next part that I want to talk about when it comes to this whole bookkeeping process, because bookkeeping is part estimates, part invoicing, and a huge part of all the other receipts. If you think about it, your P&L, profit and loss, this is probably one of the most important pieces of paper documents that are created within your business, your profit and loss. And your profit and loss has two parts, profit and loss. So the profit piece is getting paid, all right? So that's why I'm putting so much energy into the first half. You've got to make sure that the money that your business takes in gets taken care of, which then leads us to the loss part of bookkeeping, which is the receipts side. And your receipts are going to be a lot of different things. It's going to be the products that you purchase for whatever it is that you do for your clients or that you sell. It's going to be the expenses for you to be able to run your business. It could be your rent, it could be supplies, and it's going to be your payroll or anything else that you do. All right. So these things also have to get keyed in. So on a regular basis, you got to make sure that these receipts that you collect through the week also, or daily, preferably daily, if not weekly, you need to get those keyed into your system, whether you're using FreshBooks or QuickBooks or some other type of accounting, which we'll talk about in a minute. You need to make sure that those get keyed in because they are all part of the bigger picture of the profit of your company. And as we continue down this road of talking about profit, because that's what I want to try to do over the next couple of weeks on our Monday tips, is we need to make sure that we get all this information captured. So you got to remember that if you're not doing this, you're having bigger headaches because you don't know how much money. It's like having a paycheck. You know, go personally for a minute. Let's just say you get paid X amount. You work for, you're in receiving in Walmart and you get paid and you get, $4,000 a month, whatever. I'm just picking a number. You get $4,000 a month. But meanwhile, you just start paying everything and you're never paying attention to your check. You never look in your bank account to see how much money you've got. You just keep writing checks left and right. Well, guess what? That's the same thing that you're doing in your business. And that is poor money management. And you can't keep doing that. You're costing yourself money. And you're also creating some really bad spending habits and trends because you're not catching anywhere that you have broken processes. You're not capturing when you're overspending on stuff. You're not capturing the fact that, you know what, at the end of the month, no wonder why you have no money to pay yourself because you're not watching where your money's going. And that is by far the biggest reason why people do not have any money. That take-home pay we keep talking about, the biggest reason you don't have it is because you get to the end of the month, you finally jam through and try to key all this stuff in, and you find out there's nothing left. You're doing it wrong. And we're going to talk about this, but for right now, it all starts with we got to fix the process first, and we got to fix your bookkeeping first. So hopefully this part is making sense. You know, another key part to bookkeeping is it has to do more with your sales, obviously, your expenses by category, but you also can key in and watch what's going on within categories. So for example, when I talked about my ice cream shop and what I would do in the morning, a lot of it had to do with I was also keying in the numbers by category. So I knew which categories were doing what types of sales. So I knew by day, I knew by week, I knew by month, because later as I went to work on my sales and my categories, I could spend the right amount of time in the right categories because I knew what portions all created not only the most sales, but also what created the most profits. So bookkeeping is much bigger than what you get paid, the invoicing, and everything else. Your bookkeeping actually can encompass a lot of different numbers that help you drive your sales, which then drive your profit, which then drives you putting $100,000 into your pockets. Okay, so bookkeeping, you want to think bigger picture here. So yes, I'm going to sound like a broken record, but you need it, and we're going to make sure that we drive this point home. The biggest thing that you want to do is you want to try to make this easy for you. You want to remind yourself, as much as you hate it, you're doing this to put more money in your pocket. If every time you sit down and you're like, oh, I hate this process, just put a big smile on your face and say, this is how I'm getting to $100,000 in my pocket by doing this. And set that schedule up and make it happen. Now, earlier I've mentioned QuickBooks and FreshBooks. All right, these are two of the most common programs that are out there for you to do it. Now, can you do your bookkeeping on the old school way on a little ledger? Yeah, if you're still doing it that way from 50 years ago, oh my gosh, quit torturing yourself. I know you've got it down that way, but it's not the best way to do it. For most of us, we're going to use something like QuickBooks and FreshBooks. And what's great about both of these is they can be used in a brick and mortar or they can be used in a small business that's mobile. I've used both, and I'm going to share with you what my thoughts are. When I had my ice cream shop, I used QuickBooks. And there's two types of QuickBooks. One is the hard copy that goes on your computer. That's the one that we had for the longest time. Very difficult program to use. I consider myself pretty good when it comes to computer stuff. And that was a pain in the keister for me to learn to use and set up the way that I wanted to get the information that I wanted. Once I had it down, it wasn't so bad. So QuickBooks, not too bad. And then now they've come out with the online version, which is what I recommend for almost anything now, because then you can access it from your phone, from your computer, you can access it from anything. But QuickBooks is a really good solid one. It's probably the number one used program out there for software for bookkeeping. But later I discovered something called FreshBooks. And FreshBooks is something that I recommend to all the local small business owners that I talk to. And the reason that I do that is their interface, the way you, when you go online and you go to use it, is so simple and so easy to use. And what's nice about it is it has, and QuickBooks has some of this stuff too. It's just a matter of which one's easier to use. What I love about FreshBooks is you can put your estimates in there, your quotes, you can put in your invoicing, and it all rolls right into your program after you get paid. You can set it up to where you send the email off, they click on the button, and guess what? They pay you right there because you can integrate it with credit cards. So you don't even have to have a credit card account. It can set you up something, or you can set up one if you can get better. I mean, obviously, you're going to get better. Interest and stuff like that if you set something else up. So you can shop around for that. But if you don't want to mess with any of that, it's got one that's integrated with inside of the FreshBooks program, which is really nice. And you can do what one of the vendors I work with now is, if there's a fee attached to it, he just adds it to it. Say, look, you can pay by check or cash and you're going to have this part. It's a discount. But if you pay online, you're going to pay this additional fee. So he just rolls the fee right into the invoice and lets them make the decision if they want to pay it. So that helps offset his costs. Pretty smart, I thought. And you know what? Most people are going to go with convenience and they'll pay that extra money just to be able to pay online. So I really like FreshBooks and what it has allowed for my the folks that I'm working with, the ones that have gone onto it. Now it varies because it's, you know, and this is going to be with QuickBooks too. You know, you want to look into the cost for it because you can keep a whole program with your different, as part of it, it'll remember who your clients are. So if you have the same clients over and over, you kind of can keep them in there and you can track their history and know what they've spent with you over the time frame. Now, for some of you, you might be changing those out all the time. That's fine too. But you know what? You can get basic trials, free trials, and stuff like that. So, I mean, I love FreshBooks. And if you're interested in checking that out, head on over to localsmallbusinesscoach.com/FreshBooks. localsmallbusinesscoach.com/FreshBooks. Now, I'm going to be, in pure honesty, I am an affiliate for them. But like I said, I'm only affiliates. I'm really not even, I think that for that and for a website thing. But that's not why I recommended it. I recommended this long before I ever had an affiliate thing with them. I just really believe strongly and I use it. It's just a really great, solid program for local small business owners. I think you're going to love it too, especially because it does have that all-in-one service for estimates, invoicing, general accounting, stuff like that. You get the detailed itemized. You can even set it up to where if you've got something that's reoccurring every single month, it'll automatically put that in there for you. So talk about time saving. Oh my gosh. Remember how you hate keying stuff in? Well, if it's something you get every single month, you can set it up to key that in every single month for you automatically. So that's really neat. You know, and plus, like I said earlier, I love the fact that it tells you when someone opens it so they can't sit there and say, oh, I never got it, which is always hilarious when people sit there and tell you that. So once again, localsmallbusinesscoach.com/FreshBooks. But whether you use FreshBooks, you use QuickBooks, or you use any of the other ones that are out there, there's all kinds of other types that are out there. It doesn't matter. Whatever you use, the biggest thing is this. You must set aside the time to do it. I wish there was an easier answer for you. I wish there was some magic wand I could tell you, hey, this is going to make it 10 times easier. But the reality is, if you really want to get started on $100,000 of profit in your pocket, it is going to start with your bookkeeping process and you keying stuff in. You've got to know how much money you have and how much money you're spending. And we're going to talk, like I said, we're going to talk about, this is a mission of mine over the next few weeks. We're going to dive in even deeper because I know this is a pain point all of you guys have. You need more money in your pocket. You're working so freaking hard. And yet at the end of the month, you don't have that much money left over. And part of that is because we're not paying attention to what's going out. We know semi what's coming in. Some of you might even be surprised at how much money you did or didn't do by the end of the month because you're not doing your bookkeeping on a regular basis. So please, please, please make sure that you're doing that. Now, you know, before I go, if you just say, Tammy, oh, I just don't have the time. I'm so busy. You have no idea. Well, then here's the thing. You need to find help. And even if you must pay for that help, you need to do it. And I'm telling you, you might say, oh, I just don't have the money to do it. Well, let me tell you why you have the money to do it, okay? Let's say you hire someone for $10 an hour for 5 hours a week. That's $50 or $200 a month for 20 hours of somebody coming in doing your bookkeeping. And let's just say, even if you have to pay a little bit more for that, maybe it's $15 an hour, it's still, what, $60, $65? Listen, here's the thing. And that same 20 hours, you can't tell me that you can't go out and make more than that $200, $300 that's going to cost you to hire someone to do it. All right. So if you're that busy that you can't do it, then you need to go out and find someone to do it. Because if, as long as your time is being spent on creating more sales and more profits, you'll more than be able to pay for this person. And you'll take that big headache off of your plate. But let me tell you this, no matter who you are, if you hire someone to do your bookkeeping for you and you pay them, you need to inspect what you expect. Because here's the thing, people will steal from you. And I'm not saying you might have the sweetest, nicest person in the world who's doing your bookkeeping for you, but they need to know that you are watching. And you do that by asking strategic questions. And I'll end with the story on this. When I worked for Home Depot, and as a store manager, obviously we have a bookkeeping department, and we would bring in, you know, millions of dollars a year. Every single big box retailer is bringing in $1 million a year. And then you have these people that sit in this little back office, and they go through the money and they balance the books and everything for the store before it goes off to the final accounting back east. But here's the thing. A lot of stores that had been ripped off in the past was because the management, the leadership team never checked on them. They left these people touching stacks and stacks and stacks of money and just left them to do that. Never paid attention, never asked the right questions. And you know what? There's ways to finagle things no matter how you do it. And people would do that. So as a store manager and as an assistant manager over the bookkeeping department at different times is, one, on my quest to learn it really well, because I ended up being a backup person. But what's interesting is all you have to do is ask the right questions. Just every once in a while, just start poking around saying, hey, how'd you come up with that number? Even though you just have to act like you know what you're talking about, get them to explain it back to you and go, okay. You need to be dangerous to them. You need to know more than what, you know, you need to give the impression, let me put it that way, that you know more than what it is that you know. Personally, I want you to know it. Don't get me wrong. Number one is I want you to know it. But if you just cannot wrap your head around some of this, ask enough questions to be dangerous. If you hire someone, just follow up on them. You know, they're not, I don't want you all not to hire someone because you think they're going to steal from you. That's not the point of this. You just find the right person that you trust and just follow up on a regular basis. That's what I care about. The biggest thing is it needs to be done. It needs to be done every morning or at worst once a week. You need to stay on top of this. This is step one on making sure that you get $100,000 in your pockets. That's our mission. That's our goal. We're going to continue to talk about some stuff on that, but I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up. That's your biggest mission right now, is make a commitment to yourself that you're going to start doing this at the beginning of the day, the end of the day, or you're going to pick a day of the week to make sure you stay on top of this. Let's make this happen. Let's get you on your way to $100,000 profit in your pocket. Not your company's profit. I'm talking about the part you get to take home every single year. All right. I'll talk to you later. Bye. Hey, before you go, I just have one little favor. If you have a subject, a topic, a question that you would like have answered on the show or talked about, please shoot me a message over at Tammy@localsmallbusinesscoach.com. Once again, I want to hear from you. So shoot it over to me, Tammy@localsmallbusinesscoach.com.